Here we go.
Woo!
I touched a button and it automatically faded it down like that. Wasn't that impressive?
Holy cow. We're so close to professional now. We better be careful. People will stop thinking it's us.
Yes, but well, in order for them to know that it's us, here comes the famous special effect, zoom. Except I'm using a new camera, so now it's way out of focus, so I can't even reach close enough to fill the screen.
I gotcha.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, what do I have to do to get a mug?
You don't have a mug? Well, we will fix that. We will fix that. I thought you had a mug. Well, we'll get that solved. Brent, let's push that button. No kidding. Let's push that button and bring it down a little bit more. Hey, everybody. Wow, that's the longest we've danced in a while, and I'm out of breath. I got to get back to my aerobics classes as soon as this COVID thing is over. My leg warmers are just sitting in the closet waiting for me.
I noticed your cheeks are a little puffy. You've been putting on a little bit of weight from just not working out so much?
Yeah, it's the Christmas cookies. I'm already into the baking season.
I can say that to you because, you know, we're friends and it's all good.
Yep. We share certain similar pathways with age and activity levels and things. Yeah, no, I'm into winter chubby cheeks. Winter chubby cheeks. Totally. All right, so topic. What are we doing?
We're talking about cool stuff with artificial intelligence and a fantastic guest today. Who's our guest, Chris?
We have Margie Meacham back with us today. Oh, my God. How can I stumble on that? Margie, it's been a while since you've been with us. Margie, give us your 30-second bio so folks know, if they haven't met you before in our world, they know who you are.
Okay. Hi. I see a few familiar, I was going to say faces, but avatar names, you know, whatever. Hey, hello, Joe. I see Joe Ganchi. I see I'm sounding like the romper room lady. I don't know. I'm not very good at answering in 30 seconds.
Take whatever you need.
Go 60. It's all good.
I started being interested in the brain actually when I was a little girl because I'm dyslexic. And I had trouble in school. Nobody knew why. We didn't actually find out till I was in college. But that trouble made me interested in being a teacher. And then taking my education courses is when I studied different learning disabilities. And I went up to my professor and said, hey, I think I'm dyslexic. And she was like, trust me, you would know if you were dyslexic. I'm like, no, really. And that tested me. And sure enough, that's when I found out. And I had stumbled on most of the strategies they now teach kids, you know, just by working really hard, because my family was like all A's. We weren't going to have a student who, you know, who failed. So my little sister taught me how to read. I spent countless hours taking notes, retaking notes, organizing notes. So, you know, so I got through school and was all set to be an English teacher in high school. And I got a summer job in telecommunications at a technology company. And I was supposed to develop leads for salespeople. And I kept closing the deals. So I thought I was going to be in trouble. And they're like, oh, my God, we want to hire you. So, you know, it was a whole lot more money. And after a couple of years of doing very well, because all I did was go out and teach people. That's what I knew how to do. I taught them about the product. And so they said, would you like to train salespeople? And there I was back in education, in adult education. Went back, got my master's in adult education and specialized in learning technology, and didn't take long to realize that the consultants I was hiring as I started to move up in that organization made a lot more money than I did. And so I went out to be a consultant and worked with all kinds of different businesses, met wonderful people like everybody here. And thank you, Joe. Some people who know me know that I just treated myself to a new look. So.
You look fabulous.
Thank you. As I was doing that, I got really interested in what was happening in neuroscience, where we can now watch what the brain does. Yeah. And I don't know how many of you guys studied all kinds of learning models in school. If you did, give me a quick idea to raise your hand, memorized all these different learning models. Well, that's what science does. If we can't see something and test it directly, which is the preferred way, we make educated guesses. And to the extent that they can predict behavior, we say, well, this is a model. Well, the problem with learning was you could make up just about anything and make it apply in some way. And what we're now discovering is a lot of those models, they're not particularly valuable now that we know the actual transmission of energy from neuron to neuron and how that encodes information and how we retrieve it. But one has stood the state test of time, and that's constructivism, for those of you who remember, which is basically that reality is created in the brain of each person. And that's what learning is. So the truth is, none of us on this call and no authoring tool or any other technology makes us learn. We choose to learn. And that's probably the biggest aha. It's about attention. It's about conscious attention and content. And that's a battle, especially nowadays, right? To pay attention to anything. Yeah, I knew there'd be a few fellow travelers in here, Adam. So that's why I wanted to mention it. So don't bother studying any of the others. sorry if that offends somebody. But they're just quaint historical episodes now. And maybe your program has caught up with that. Maybe it hasn't. You might have also noticed the field, the entire field of psychology is now neuroscience-based. They made a major decision a few years ago and went in that direction, changed all their documentation, and have asserted that whether we can tell or not, we now believe that psychological challenges and issues and behaviors have a biological source. That's what generates these difficulties for people. It's a chemical imbalance, or it's a timing electrical thing, or it's an injury. It's a pathway from that has been created from a trauma. And those neurons keep firing, even though the experience is over. Well, despite that, there are still people who are out there saying, well, neuroscience doesn't have anything to offer the learning profession. The evidence is so clear now that I think those people have let history pass them by. But that's what
I don't know who would say that, but yeah.
Oh, I could give you a couple of well-known names, but
Not name drop people.
We will.
So, we won't shame anybody.
Some of those same people are now saying the same thing about artificial intelligence. That's just hype. It's not, we're nowhere near using any of it. Also not true. So denying science has a way of ultimately making you look foolish. But here is how I got into artificial intelligence. They're both brains. They're both neural networks. The sciences have been converging for the last 10 years. And I noticed that a little while ago. And I wrote a little blog post about it. And a neuroscientist actually got in touch with me and said, you're one of the first people to call it out. I've been working with IT professionals for years because they understand some things about the signaling that I need to use in my work. And I'm helping them build a better AI. So the two fields are converging. And that's very exciting for us as learning professionals, because while we don't have to be neuroscientists or artificial intelligence experts, we do need to be aware of what those sciences offer us, what we can do with those insights. And let's see, I have, Adam has a comment. The problem is that some people using neurobiology, yeah, some people, here is the biggest problem with applying any science, is that the pop press doesn't like complexity. They want a sound bite. And so they reduce important journal peer-reviewed discoveries to a headline. And that's what's bogus. that is what drives some of these folks crazy that then go the other way and say, well, you can't trust any of it. You can't use any of it, because they'll key in on the one or two things that are misrepresented. So that's so that's what I see as my role, is I help organizations apply that stuff logically and effectively. And in the course of that, I felt like I had to write a book. I had one book, Brain Matters. Some of you may actually own it. It's doing very well still. And I was talking to a friend at ATD, which a lot of us, how many folks are members or aware of ATD, Association for Talent Development? You guys probably know them. Well, he said, look, why don't we publish that? And I thought, well, yeah, that's great. It's an honor. Very different experience from just sitting down writing whatever the heck you want, you know, a real publisher with an editor. Thank you, Kim. So I wrote this book, and it's shipping December 15th, and it's called AI and Talent Development. And so that's, I had a few people say, well, what are your credentials to write about artificial intelligence? Well, one is I did the research. I spent a year doing research, and it just naturally made sense to me because I had been spending about 10 years studying neural networks in one way or another. And so,
It's strange to me that people get so hung up on, you got to have all the right PhDs from all the right institutions and from all, this, that, and the other thing. And then you get to be, then everybody's okay with you writing the book, as opposed to just being smart enough to go out and read all of the literature and the research and be interested enough to connect the dots and to write a book about your thoughts and how you connect it all together. And, if you're sourcing everything and referencing it, I don't know.
Yeah.
So that's another tangent, I suppose. But how do we get people, to start thinking more about artificial intelligence in talent development? Because I think still in the industry, people are like, nah, that's the IT department. It's those other people. It's not really for us just yet.
We are actually behind a lot of other industries. We're not completely outside of it. But for example, I think where it starts is with noticing it all around you, because we're not talking about future thing here. We're talking about applications that are real world. For example, when you get on a plane again, with that, the flight pattern is all monitored by highly sophisticated artificial intelligence system. The human beings, the flight control people, are of course very important. And a lot of times these applications marry humans and what humans do well with what AI does well. So correlating learning content with needed skills. Perfect, Adam. How much stuff do you guys have? And how do you match it? We have been seeking, that's the holy grail of the learning profession, isn't it? Truly personalized down to the individual.
Yeah.
And how do we do that? How do we know what that person needs and when they need it? Well, there's actually a lot of interesting work being done on that in China, where they don't have enough professors and teachers at any level for the number of students that they have. They built it by necessity, and they've got a lot of smart minds there. And there are something like, the last time I looked, I'm sure it's more now, about 3 million students who are taught entirely by an algorithm. And this is in grades K through 12. And what happens is they log on and the system has a record of all their clicks, all the responses. Did they take time when they answered the quiz? That is a different event than if they answer that question right away. And delivers the next lesson based on past performance.
Wow. Yeah, that is the holy grail, right? That's what everybody's trying to come up with, is personalization of learning and all of that. And You know, we try desperately to code that into our little programs that we create, but sounds like they've got us a little bit more advanced.
It's really just a matter of getting the right team in the room. That's not a make-believe application. That is something any business could have. It would take it right now. Nobody has monetized it into a product. I would expect an LMS company to do that fairly soon. If you have the right, a lot of companies already have data scientists and the type of specialists in their firm. For example, if you're in financial services, you absolutely have an AI department somewhere.
Yeah.
You just need to go find it. And they might be able to build that for you.
Well, people are probably in that space. I'm guessing there's a lot of AI in the credit department, right? When they're trying to decide how much credit they're willing to give you. I mean, they probably crunch a gazillion numbers and all the data that they have collected on you to see if you're worth loaning money to and all that kind of stuff, right?
Yes.
There's your credit score and how that gets calculated and all that kind of stuff. And, let's not go there, but.
Yeah.
But
and
it
is, in fact, potentially an issue. And because just like human beings, AIs can make decisions we wish they wouldn't make. And there have been some highly publicized cases where, see, it depends on how you train it. So there was a famous case, and we won't name the company, and they fessed up and took it down. They admitted, hey, this isn't working. They thought they could enhance the diversity of their staff by taking human beings out of the screening process. They were suspected women and people of color were being screened out at the resume evaluation level. So they took a bunch of resumes. Now listen, and you guys tell me where you think they made a mistake. They took a bunch of resumes of successful candidates who were doing great jobs and said, this is what we're looking for. And put that as the brain of the AI, taught it to look for those things. So what results do you think they got from that?
A replication of the pattern that already exists and probably
exactly.
Even an amplification of that pattern. Yeah.
Because now that was the only was that unconscious bias of the white male people who had selected.
It's built into it. Yeah.
People like themselves. So that's the really kind of fun thing I found about researching the book is AI does exactly what you tell it. And it's really, in most cases, really AI is such a misnomer. And I liked your point, Taruna, about augmented intelligence. You and I need to talk, because very often that's what it's doing. It's augmenting.
Sure.
It's taking the grunt work out of it. It's great at recognizing patterns. So are we, but AI is quicker at it.
Yeah.
So it can find tumors, and it does a lot of analysis on tumor. But these are algorithms. These aren't little robot creatures that talk to you and tell jokes, and they're not like you see in the movies, and they don't, so far as we know, they don't have feelings.
Yeah, they're only as smart as the data you give it.
Yeah.
Give them.
And they'll only do what you teach it. So an AI that's been taught to evaluate financial information can't suddenly develop some new capability, although they are working on how can they create one that will do exactly that, will teach itself, will recognize a change in the business and develop a new skill. So
I'm wondering this could be a stretch, but let me see if I can connect a couple dots. So we talk about marketing a lot, and we know marketing tools and marketing platforms have had the ability to kind of track users' behavior online, and they're able to then offer you products and services and things based on things that you've bought and where you've gone and what your interests are and all of that kind of stuff. And so we know that at that level, that stuff is good, but how can we apply the same thing to, like, let's say management leadership development to help guide behaviors? Oh, don't worry, I'll come back. There I am.
Yeah, Yeah, because that's right.
What I'm thinking, right? Because I think that's one of the spots that people have the most difficulty developing training for, I think, because it's really hard. It's because it's such, it's so behavioral based, and people become leaders based on like an entire life's worth of experiences, and training departments think you can get, send them to a workshop for a weekend, and all of a sudden they're different, and they are all of a sudden can be, you know, really effective. Maybe there's subtle guidances that AI can kind of help instead to sort of remold people into being better leaders or something like that. Is anything like that existing or working?
Yeah, I haven't found a lot of people actually using it, but one of the, to me, that is one of the most interesting and most promising ways to use it would be maybe through something called a chatbot. And Taruna, you make a good point that AI is all around us. We just need to start recognizing it. And one of the things that's been around for years and years is the chatbot. And as a matter of fact, I've been here with this group and talked about it. And Joe Ganchi and I did a couple of workshops on it to show people that it's a new way to deliver e-learning. So instead of a lot of branching scenarios, you can have a conversation and the illusion of conversation. And that's important because, you know, it's very easy to anthropomorphize. I always stumble on that word, but, you know, make this into an actual human being and maybe get too wrapped up in the emotions. But a little bit of that is actually why they work, because we like to talk to each other and we would much prefer to practice with another person than with a screen. And, you know, no matter how well you design a branching scenario, it's not going to account for everything. But the beauty of doing a chatbot, if it's got artificial intelligence behind it, is that it adapts to each individual user, to their strengths, to what's happening in the conversation at the time, so they can practice it over and over again. They can get some of their 10,000 hours of mastery through practice with a well-designed chatbot. And the great thing about them is the more they are used by the users, the better they get. Classic example is the university then had a teaching assistant that was effectively a chatbot communicated by email. But the underlying design was a chatbot. And instead of the way you usually see it. And the students all believed it was a real human being. They thought she wasn't a very good teaching assistant at first, but by the end of the term, they loved her, said she was the best they ever had, and they nominated her for an award. So, and they're still using that chatbot, and now everybody knows, you know, and they take the course in order to engage with an effective AI.
We've got a couple of things. Kim's mentioning that she recently had a chatbot experience. It trained me very well on how to use a complex online discussion forum. It was an amazing experience. Plenty of AI. I talked about it for weeks. That's really cool.
Yeah, really.
And Paul is mentioning, and this is something that was on my mind as we were coming into this. Cortana sends me an email each day trying to set up my daily tasks. It looks at my meetings and shows documents that I might need for them. Our organization recently must have turned on the Cortana emails. I've been getting them for about 2 weeks. I don't know, Brent, if you've been getting them too. And I have to admit, they provide no value for me. What I found, like yesterday's Cortana bulletin, was pulling up things from 4 days ago, which I had resolved already, but it's saying this person was, no, I got on the phone. So contextually, what Cortana is currently feeding me as info is it's out of the loop enough that it's not providing any value to me.
Does it give you the chance to give it feedback? Does it ask, was this helpful?
Yes, actually, it does have buttons underneath it. But my reaction to it is I scan it out of curiosity mostly.
You're making the Cortana feel bad, Chris. You're not giving it the proper respect it deserves and the feedback that you need. You can't poo-poo the AI. Come on, feed it.
The point that actually I was getting to, and Joe said it, is I would encourage you, this is one way to start seeing the possibilities, because I felt the same way with my virtual assistant, with Siri. I found her incredibly annoying at first. But, you know, it's, if you hired a human being, they're going to do all kinds of bonehead things at first, right? Until they learn your preferences and get up to speed. So if you take the time to train it, and that's actually the word that's used, and give it feedback and say, no, that wasn't helpful, and yes, this was, and it sees how you interact with it. It's also, it's tracking all kinds of subtle things, like how often you open it, and do you then take the clicks it recommends? And the more you interact with it, the better it gets. And that I can tell you.
A lot of these really cool examples that you're talking about, they're in your book, right? So if people buy your book, they're going to be able to see and go and then obviously referenced to and get to the research themselves and to look into this stuff. Because it really sounds like there's a lot of folks that are really interested in this and find it quite fascinating. So
that's right. If you help them, they help you. So in researching it, a lot of times I had to translate. I found something, wow, that's really great. It's being done in, say, a marketing company or a financial services company, but could we use it? Just like we've been talking here. And then, of course, there are the U.S. government and China are two examples that in their learning and development are making substantial use of artificial intelligence. Not all of it is available to us to know about, but what is public is pretty pretty impressive.
Yeah.
Another area that's really useful for these intelligences is in context, not so much in training as we think of it, but in performance management and in the moment coaching. So if you're working on a system, I have a client that has, they're a technology company and they have a lot of technicians out in the field. And they have a chatbot that only appears if the technician hesitates or goes to the wrong place in the system. It'll come up and say, would you like help? And if it's ignored, like Chris does with Gordana, if it's ignored, but the behavior is still not right, it gets a little more insistent. It says, it looks like you're looking, you know, to input a new order. You need to be over here. And so they don't have to do as much training because that safety net is there. And then they get all this data in the back end. The other great thing about it is once you put a tool like this in place, you get to see down to the individual if you want, what are they struggling with? Well, there might be certain topics everybody is missing and the chatbot is, it's kind of like the chatbot saying, hey, could you please train these guys on, you know, how to reroute the network because every one of them is coming to me. So, you know, that's a problem. And so it makes your training better. It might help you identify best practices like, wow, you know, this guy over here, he actually skipped three steps and it turns out we didn't need those three steps. So then you also need, because you're going to get tons of data, you need another algorithm to sort through that data and present the patterns to you. And then human beings to decide if those patterns are significant and actionable.
And that's what you've just described there. I mean, Paul had a question that he popped in a little bit, and I've been sitting waiting to bring it in. Paul's asking in the question panel, so if AI is going to deliver the learning path and deliver the training, what's our role in the process? Because, it sort of maybe does start to evoke a little bit of an existential crisis for those of us who, you know, create content and et cetera. Where do we fit in, you know?
Well, and that is a legitimate question for any professional. And there's actually a famous book, Will You Be Replaced by a Robot? And there's a website you can go to, but say name, if you put in your job title, it'll tell you the chances that you'll be replaced by a robot. By the way, ours are pretty low. Here's why. Because our jobs still have a lot of judgment and creativity in them, which are two things that are pretty difficult right now for algorithms to do. But they can do some cool things that will make our jobs easier, give us more time for creativity and for exploring new ways to do things. So you mentioned content development. You're probably reading news articles on the web all the time that were written by algorithms.
Yeah, so you know what's, yeah, you know, the my first experience with auto writing of reports or whatever came from doing fantasy football. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the fantasy football systems and platforms that are out there, but you know, right? You build your team based on the players. You got a whole bunch of, you got like 12 teams, right? And they're all uniquely combined. So every group that's playing, it's has a unique weekly experience when a game occurs. You get an email that recaps your team's performance. And it's very specific to your players. It drops your name in there as the coach and says, you know, Coach Schlenker played XYZ. They did this. And it's all algorithm based because there's obviously there's leagues and there's like thousands and thousands of these leagues. So there aren't people writing these email newsletters. And so when I would see that email come in, I was like, oh my gosh, this is auto-generated and it's good. Yeah. It was really good.
Yeah. It's, and so if you can get help generating a job aid or the first bones of a PowerPoint presentation that you can then go in and edit from there, it really is like having a little junior assistant, little, you know. The biggest challenge is, as learning departments, where do we get the funding for this?
That at the end of the day, I guess that's what it all boils down to, right? Do we have that kind of money?
Yeah. Now, there's a really a lot of interesting conversations going on in the chat, too.
Yeah.
Thank you for putting in the AI paintings. That's and, you know, some AIs have written music in the style of great composers like Mozart and Beethoven and fooled experts. They said, oh my gosh, we've discovered a new, you know, a new work. But all of those are very, very specific. And the point that Joe is making, I actually spend a lot of time in the book on, is so that we're real clear about what we're talking about. We're talking about weak AI or limited AI, targeted AI, not general intelligence or strong AI like Commander Data on Star Trek. And I think that is one thing people sometimes react to if they want to dispel it. It's because they're thinking, oh, we're not anywhere near that. And they're right. We're not anywhere near that. And some very smart people like Elon Musk think before that happens, we'll actually merge with our machines and we'll be the AI. It will change the human race. So who knows how that's going to go. But yeah, that's an important point to make.
There's a big gap between what you just mentioned, right? Between like data from Star Trek and maybe what we can code inside an authoring tool or something like that, right? And or a basic, what do you call it? A basic if-then statement, right? Mm-hmm. That we can code and create that's kind of, we can fake that it seems like AI, or maybe we can even put a very simple version of a chatbot at the bottom end of that. So you've got the bottom end and you've got the real high end. You got data from Star Trek. There's a lot
chatbots,
of
in fact, are not
opportunities and different types of what AI is in the middle. And it feels like that's the hardest part for us at this point to have these conversations, is that everybody has their own idea of where they fit in that spectrum when they're talking about AI, right? And so being able to ground the conversation in our industry, I've found to be very difficult.
Yeah, and that's one thing I actually think I'm kind of good at. I write about complicated.
That's why I'm glad you wrote the book, because I think your book is going to help the industry, you know, sort of get a baseline and start to figure that stuff out.
Yeah, and you know, like-minded people in our field are going to start figuring it out. And I'm going to have, I don't have it up yet, but I'm going to have a page on my website dedicated to this so that people can come and share ideas and post examples and we can keep the conversation going beyond the book, because you know, a book can never be completely up to date. I have the same problem with Brain Matters. I've updated it 5 times every year. I update it because, you know, the fields, science moves, generally science moves slowly, but neuroscience and artificial intelligence are moving very quickly. And so nearly any book is going to be at least a little bit out of date. So the minute it comes off the shelves, I do my best. And, you know, it's just one more tool, but you need to be educated about it. We have this amazing tool out there. And I think the most important thing, if you could get this from our conversation today, is I'm going to learn more about it. I'm going to maybe, if you work inside a company, go over and talk to your IT department and say, hey, do we have any people who are developing AI for us? You know, if you get the right person interested in your use case, they might do it just for fun. You know, you might get lucky. And if not, at least you understand, you know, how it works. You might find something they're doing for customers, for example, and you could say, you know what, I have internal customers, I have learners. Could we modify this into something I could use? And get to know your virtual assistant and really invest a little time in training them and start to ask yourself, what if a learner had an assistant like that? Because those virtual assistants can also be tailored to be learning assistants. That would be another thing. There are tons of companies that will let you build a chatbot for free. As a matter of fact, I just did a workshop, a 2.5-hour workshop for ATD online. And we all logged on to the same free tool. I just picked one I liked. And by the end of it, we had built a chatbot, a working chatbot, just as a demonstration to show people how easy it is. So, and if you need something bigger and fancier, of course, there's plenty of companies happy to do that for you. But I would urge you to get more educated first in terms of what's possible, what isn't, what kinds of things should be done, and be make sure they make everything transparent. If you're going to use a vendor, a good one will be happy to explain things to you because you want to know how they make that decision. For example,
right.
Someone should have been able to stop that hiring fiasco if they had understood how the builders had decided to train it. You know, that someone probably didn't ask the question of, well, how are you going to do this? So, you know, those would be my couple of big takeaways for you guys.
Very cool.
As we start to get close to the end of our time here today, I'd like to throw it out to the chat and just say, hey, anybody in the chat, have you done chat work? I know. And I wanted to mention, too, that Adam, it may have gone by fast for everybody, but Adam mentioned AWS offering up an AI system that you can tap into as well. Some of these other free links, I'm sure, Margie, if people just obviously if they read your book or go to your website, but if they just Googled, you know, free AI chatbot systems or whatever, people can find stuff that way as well. But has anybody in the chat done anything like this? Or have you taken Margie's course and actually done this or her workshop and played through with it? I'd be curious to know if we've got some experiences that we can all start talking about as well. And, you know, maybe we can get some of you folks to be a guest on Idiotic at some point if you've done this kind of thing before.
Well, I'm not typing in because I haven't done it, but it is totally, it's totally fascinating. Yesterday, I was having my lunch at home and I had the radio on and the local CBC was doing its call-in show over lunch. And its topic was actually AI. What's your experience been? And it was really neat to see the people who called in. It was broken down into two clumps, maybe not 50-50, maybe like a 2/3, 1/3. There were the people who, I have no use for it. It drives me nuts, et cetera. But 2/3 of the folks or so who called in were folks who described having a problem, whether that was maybe a vision issue or you know, something in that range. And then just describing how having, you know, that talking box on the counter has actually altered their life. And most of them also included something anecdotal about how that how the personality of that box talking to them, not just simplifying how they can find out an information that they need because, you know, vision impairment or something like that at a glance, but also that personality of adding that extra kind of, you know, piece to their life as well.
Yeah, no. And, you know, there's a real interesting phenomenon. A couple of times we used the word creepy. I even used it called the uncanny valley. And I spent some time in the book about this, the psychological feeling you get when you realize suddenly that you have been connecting with a machine. You know, at first it's kind of cool. And then they say something so uncannily real that you kind of bounce back. Because we're not used to it yet. Eventually we'll get over that. Some of you may have seen my phone was advertising this darling little puppy. I thought, oh my God, someone's actually selling puppies now on the internet. And I was just enchanted. You might've noticed my little friends behind me. I've got two dogs of my own and I'm babysitting a third right now. And it's just the cutest thing. And it's following its owner around and it's playing games. And then I suddenly had the realization from the text on the screen that it was a robot, that this was a robot that you train and you develop its personality. And it's very popular in Japan, but we haven't been able to get it. Now you can. And it was like, ew. And then I realized, oh yeah, there it was. That's the uncanny valley.
Yeah. It's right there. Well, there's, if anybody has seen the movie, what's it called? Machinima or Maxinima or I forget what it is. It's kind of creepy. It's a little slow going at first, but it has an epic twist. And so it's worth watching if you're into this kind of stuff. And if you're familiar with the Uncanny Valley and everything. But yeah, it really makes you think, but wow, our thinking time has been thought out. It's time for us to dance an ex machina. That's what it is, Joe. Thank you.
And that's a reference in the Greek. It means God, you know, it's Deus ex machina, God from the machine. It's a reference to the Greek, ancient Greek plays. And they used to, the gods always came in at the end. And they had a machine that rose up that was kind of like a robot that they may be the guy. So yep. Very interesting. Even back then, they were thinking about how do we create a creature.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. you know what, Margie? Thank you so much for talking us through this. This is a complicated topic, and we need somebody to help kind of ground us in these conversations. And I always appreciate you coming and talking us through it.
Yeah, I'd love to hear from you guys. I just threw just my email in the. And by the way. For those of you who follow me on Twitter, I'm very sorry. I'm left out of Twitter right now, but please tell me. I'm working on it.
The big irony, Margie is having to prove that she's not an AI robot right now.
Yeah, the world just keeps doing fun things to us like that, huh?
The Deus Ex Machina works in mysterious ways, I guess. Yeah. Margie, thanks so much for joining us. It's always a pleasure to have you with us. Thanks to everyone in the chat. This has been a great chat. I know I say that every week, but every week it is a great chat. And there's been so many extra things thrown in. So if folks are listening to us on, say, the podcast version and you ever get a chance to come into the Crowdcast recording, do check out the chat because there's lots more going on there for sure. Guys, have a great rest of the week. We have one more session next week and then that's it for us for until the holiday break is over. We're drinking and drawing again next week with Kevin Thorne, so that's going to be a fun time as we always have when Kevin joins us. We all get a little bit better at making pretty pictures because some of us aren't necessarily so confident without Kevin's awesome boost to our abilities and our egos.
Guys, excellent tutelage.
His excellent work too. Yeah, guys, thanks so much for joining us and we will catch you guys next episode. Margie, thanks so much. Let's dance on out of here.
Woo! I'm going to have you do the special effect again, sorry.
I just clued in, yep.
I lost my job.
And I'm a robot. Oh, thanks, everybody. Have a great rest
of the week.
Have
a great week, everybody.
Talk to you later.